Hello and welcome to the theater. My name is Shana Bestock. I'm the producing artistic director of Penguin Productions. It's my joy to welcome you this evening or whenever it is that you happen to be watching this, and to thank you for joining us in this incredible project. We started our rehearsal process right at the beginning of quarantine, and it has been such a joy and privilege to work with these remarkable young artists during these interesting times. Connecting to them, watching them connect to each other, and us all connecting to this incredible play has been a rich and rewarding adventure. So thank you for your support of Penguin Productions, of these young artists, and for inspiring us to keep taking creative adventures to fuel our future. Enjoy the show.
Tell me, my daughters, which of you shall we say doth love us most? Goneril, our eldest born, speak first.
Sir, I love you more than words can wield the matter. Dearer than eyesight, space, and liberty. Beyond what can be valued, rich, or rare. No less than life, with grace, health, beauty, honor, as much as child e'er loved or father found. A love that makes breath poor and speech unable. Beyond all manner of so much I love you.
If all these bounds, even from this line to this, we make thee lady, what says our second daughter, her dearest Regan? Speak.
What, sir, I am made of the selfsame metal that my sister is, and prize me at her worth. In my true heart I find she names my very deed of love. Only she comes too short, that I profess myself an enemy to all other joys, which the most precious square of sense possesses, and find I'm alone felicitate in your dear highness love.
To thee this ample third of our fair kingdom, no less in space, validity, and pleasure than that conferred on Goneril. Now our joy. Although last, not least, what can you say to draw a third more opulent than your sisters? Speak.
Nothing, my lord.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Nothing will come of nothing. Speak again.
Unhappy that I am, I cannot heave my heart into my mouth. I love your majesty according to my bond. No more, no less.
How, Cordelia, mend your speech a little, lest it may mar your fortunes.
Good, my lord, you have begot me, bred me, loved me. I return those duties back as our right fit. Obey you, love you, and most honor you.
So young and so untender?
So young, my lord, and true.
Let it be so. Thy truth then be thy dower. Here I disclaim all parental care, and as a stranger to my heart and me, hold you from this forever.
Good, my liege.
Peace can't come up between a dragon and his wrath. I loved her most, and thought to set my rest on her kind nursery. Hence, and avoid my sight. Cornwall, Albany, with my two daughters' dowers, digest this third, let pride marry her. I do invest you jointly with my power. Ourselves by monthly course with reservation of 100 knights by you to be sustained, shall our abode make with you by due turns. Only we still retain the name and all additions to a king. The rest, beloved sons, be yours.
Royal Lear, whom I have ever honored as my king, loved as my father, and as my master followed.
The bow is bent and drawn, make from the shaft.
Let it fall. Be kent unmannerly when Lear is mad. Reverse thy doom.
Kent on thy life no more.
My life, I never held it as a pawn to wage against thy enemies, nor fear to lose it, thy safety being the motive.
Out of my sight.
See better, Lear, and let me still remain the true blank of thine eye.
O vassal miscreant!
You revoke thy doom. I tell thee thou dost evil.
Hear me, recreant, on thine allegiance hear me. Turn thy hated back upon our kingdom. If on the 10th day thy banished trunk be found in our dominions, the moment is thy death. Away! By Jupiter, this shall not be revoked.
Fare thee well, King. Sith thus thou wilt appear, freedom lives hence, and banishment is here. The gods to their dear shelter take thee, maid, that justly thinks and hast most rightly said. In your large speeches may your deeds approve, that good effects may spring from words of love. Thus Kent, O princes, bids you all adieu. He'll shape his old course in a country new.
You see how full of changes his age brings. He has always loved our sister most, and with what poor judgment he hath now cast her off appears too grossly.
But 'tis the infirmity of his age, yet he hath ever but slenderly known himself.
The best and soundest of his time hath been but rash. Then must we look to receive from his age unruly waywardness.
Such unconstant starts are we like to have from him, as this of Kent's banishment.
We must do something, and in the heat.
Thou, nature, art my goddess. To thy law my services are bound. Wherefore should I stand in the plague of customs and allow and permit the curiosity of nations deprive me for that I am 12 or 14 moonshine's lag of a brother? Why bastard? Wherefore base? With my mind as generous and my shape as true as honest issue? Why brand they us with base? With baseness, bastardy, base, base. Well then, legitimate Edgar, I must have your land. Fine word, legitimate. Well, my legitimate, if this letter speed and my intention thrive, Edmund the base shall top the legitimate. Now, God, stand up for bastards!
Edmund, how now? What news?
So please, your lordship, none.
Why so earnestly seek you to put up that letter?
I know no news, my lord.
What paper were you reading?
Nothing, my lord.
No? The quality of nothing hath not such need to hide itself. Come, if it be nothing, I shall not need spectacles.
I beseech you, sir, pardon me. It is a letter from my brother.
Give me the letter, sir. This policy and reverence of age makes the world bitter to the best of our times, and keeps our fortunes from us till oldness cannot relish them. I begin to find idle and fond bondage in the oppression of age tyranny, whose sway is not as it hath power, but as it is suffered. Come to me of this, I should speak more. Our father would sleep till I waked him. You should have his revenue forever. Live in the beloved of your brother, Edgar.
My son, Edgar! Had he a hand to write this, a heart and a brain to breed it? Oh, villain, villain, a natural, detested villain! He cannot be such a monster.
Nor is not sure.
And to his father that so tenderly and entirely loves him. Edmund, seek him out.
I will, sir.
These late eclipses in the sun and moon portend no good to us. There's son against father. The king falls from bias of nature. There's father against child. And the noble and true-hearted Kent banished. His offense, honesty. 'Tis strange.
This is the excellent foppery of the world, that when we are sick in fortune, often the surfeit of our own behavior, we make guilty of our disasters the sun, the moon, and the stars, as if we were villains by necessity, fools by heavenly compulsion, an admirable evasion of man. To lay his goatish disposition to the charge of a star.
How now, brother Edmund? What serious contemplation are you in?
I am thinking, brother, of a prediction I read this other day. What should follow these?
Eclipses.
Do you busy yourself about that?
I promise you, the effects he writes of succeed unhappily. Of a naturalness between the child and the parent, death, dearth, divisions in state, menaces and maledictions, banishment of friends, nuptial breaches, and I know not what.
How long have you been a sectarian astronomical?
Come, come. When saw you my father last?
Why, the night gone by.
Spake you with him?
Aye, 2 hours together.
Parted you in good terms? Found you no displeasure in him by word or countenance?
None at all.
Bethink yourself wherein you may have offended him. His displeasure rageth.
Some villain hath done me wrong.
That's my fear. I pray you, retire with me to my lodging. Pray ye, go. There's my key. If you do stir abroad, go armed.
Armed? Brother.
Brother, I advise you to the best. A credulous father and a brother noble, whose nature is so far from doing harm that he suspects none, on whose foolish honesty my practices ride easy. I see the business. Let me, if not by birth, take lands by wit. All's with me's meat that I can fashion fit.
Now banished Kent, if thou can't serve or thou dost stand condemned, thy master, whom thou lovest, shall find me full of labors.
How now? What art thou?
A man, sir.
What wouldst thou with us?
Service.
Who wouldst thou serve?
You.
Dost thou know me, fellow?
No, sir, but you have that in your countenance which I would fain call master.
What's that?
Authority.
Follow me. Thou shalt serve me. If I like thee no worse after dinner, I'll not part from thee yet. Dinner! Oh, dinner!
By day and night he wrongs me. Every hour he flashes into one gross crime or another that sets us all at odds. I'll not endure it. His nights grow riotous, and himself upbraids us on every trifle. I'll have it come to question. If he dislike it, let him to our sister, idle old man, that would still manage those authorities which he hath given away. Now, by my life, old fools are babes again, and must be used with checks as flatteries when they are seen abused. Your insolent retinue do hourly carp and quarrel, breaking forth in rank and not to be endured riots.
Are you our daughter?
Come, sir, I would you would make use of that good wisdom of which I know you are fraught, and put away these dispositions that of late transform you from what you rightly are.
Doth any here know me? This is not Lear. Doth Lear walk thus? Speak thus? Where are his eyes? Who is it that can tell me who I am?
Lear's shadow.
I should be false persuaded that I had a daughter. Your name, fair gentlewoman?
This admiration, sir, is much o' the savor of other your new pranks. I do beseech you to understand my purposes aright. As you are old and reverend, you should be wise. Here do you keep 100 knights and squires, men so disordered, so debauched, so bold, that this our court, infected with their manners, shows like a riotous inn. The shame itself doth speak for instant remedy. Be then desired to disquantity your train.
Darkness and devils! Saddle my horses, call my train together. I'll not trouble thee. Yet have I left a daughter.
You strike my people, and your disordered rabble makes servants of their betters.
Detested kite thou liest! My train are men of choice and rarest parts, that all particulars of duty know. Oh, most small fault. How ugly dost thou in Cordelia show. Oh, Lear, 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 beat at this gate that let thy folly in and thy good judgment out. Nature, hear, hear, dear goddess, hear. If she must teem, create her child of spleen, turn all her mother's pains and benefits to laughter and contempt, that she may feel how sharper than a serpent's tooth it is to have a thankless child. Blasts and fogs upon thee! Old fond eyes, beweep this cause again, I'll pluck ye out. Yea, is it come to this? Yet have I left a daughter, who I am sure is kind and comfortable. When she shall hear this of thee, with her nail she'll flay thy wolfish visage.
Do you mark that, my lord?
I cannot be so partial, Goneril.
Pray
you
to
I bear you. Well, you may fear too far.
Safer than trust too far.
How far eyes may pierce, I cannot tell. Striving to better, off we mar what's well.
How now, my pretty knave? What dost thou?
Sirrah, you were best take my coxcomb. If thou follow him, thou must needs wear my coxcomb.
Take heed, sirrah.
Sirrah, I'll teach thee a speech.
Do.
Mark it, nuncle. Have more than thou showest. Speak less than thou knowest. Lend less than thou owest. Ride more than thou goest. And thou shalt have more than 2 tens to a score.
This is nothing, fool.
You gave me nothing for it. Can you make no use of nothing, nuncle?
My noble, and nothing can be made out of nothing.
That lord that counseled thee to give away thy land, come place him here by me. Do thou for him stand. The sweet and bitter fool will presently appear. The one in Motley here, the other found out there.
Dost thou call me fool, boy?
All thy other titles were thou hast given away that thou wast born with. You shalt see thy other daughter will use thee kindly, for though she's as like this as a crab's like an apple, yet I can tell what I can tell.
I did her wrong.
Canst tell why a snail has a house?
Why?
Why, to put his head in, not to give it away to his daughters and leave his horns without a case. The reason why the 7 stars are no more than 7 is a pretty reason.
Because they are not 8?
Yes, indeed. Thou wouldst make a good fool.
Monster ingratitude.
If thou wert my fool, uncle, I'd have thee beaten for being old before thy time.
How's that?
Thou shouldst not have been old till thou hadst been wise.
Oh, let me not be mad, not mad. Sweet heaven, keep me in temper. I should not be mad.
Good dawn to thee, friend. Where we set our horses?
In the mire.
Prithee, if thou lovest me, tell me.
I love thee not.
Why dost thou use me thus? I know thee not.
Fellow, I know thee.
What dost thou know me for?
A knave. A rascal, an eater of broken meats. A base, proud, shallow, beggarly, three-suited, 100-pound, filthy, worsted stocking knave. A lily-livered, action-taking knave. A glass-gazing, super-serviceable, finical rogue. One trunk-inheriting slave. One that art nothing but the composition of a knave. Beggar, coward, in the son and heir of a mongrel bitch. One whom I will beat into clamorous whining if thou deniest the least syllable of thy addition.
Why, what monstrous fellow art thou? Best to rail on one that is neither known of thee nor knows thee.
What a brazen-faced varlet art thou, to deny thou knowest me? Is it 2 days ago since I tripped up thy heels and beat thee before the king? Draw, you whoreson and barbermonger, draw!
Away, I have nothing to do with thee!
Draw, you rascal! You come with letters against the king! Draw, you rogue girl, carbon not or your shanks!
Help!
Stand, oh, you splitter!
Murder.
Stand, rogue, strike!
Help! Oh, murder! Help! Murder, murder!
Why art thou mad, old fellow? What's his offense?
His countenance likes me not.
Fetch forth the stocks, you stubborn ancient knave, you reverend braggart. As I have life and honor, there shall ye sit till noon.
Till noon? Till night, my lord, and all night too.
Madam, if I were your father's dog, you should not use me so.
Sir, being his knave, I will.
Come, bring away the stocks.
I heard myself proclaimed, and by the happy hollow of a tree, escaped the hunt. No port is free. I will preserve myself. My face, I'll grime with filth, blanket my loins, elf all my hair in knots, and with presented nakedness, outface the winds and persecutions of the sky. The country gives me proof and precedent of bedlam beggars, who with roaring voices strike in their bare arms, pins, pricks, nails, sometime with lunatic bands, sometime with prayers, enforce their charity. Poor Tom! That's something. Edgar, I nothing am.
Hail to thee, noble master.
Ha! Makest thou this shame thy pastime?
No, my lord.
Who has he so much thy place mistook to set thee here?
It is both he and she, your son and daughter.
No.
Yes.
No, I say.
I say yea.
No, no, they would not.
Yes, they have.
By Jupiter, I swear no.
By Juno, I swear I.
They durst not do it. They would not, could not do it. 'Tis worse than murder to do upon respect such violent outrage.
Fathers that wear rags do make their children blind, but fathers that bear bags shall see their children kind.
Oh, my heart, where is this daughter? Vengeance, plague, death, confusion. Oh, Gloucester, Gloucester, I'd speak with the Duke of Cornwall and his wife.
Well, my good lord, I've informed them so.
Informed them? Dost thou understand me, man?
Aye, my good lord.
The king would speak with Cornwall. The dear father would with his daughter speak, commands her service. Are they informed of this, my breath and blood? Go, tell the dukes and wife I'd speak with them now, or at the chamber door I'll beat the drum till it cries sleep to death.
I would have all well betwixt you.
Oh, me, my heart, my rising heart.
Cry to it, nuncle.
Beloved Regan, thy sister's not. Oh, Regan, she hath tied sharp tooth unkindness like a vulture here. I can scarce speak to thee. Thou'lt not believe with how depraved a quality. Ah, Regan, my curse is on her.
Oh, sir, you are old. You should be ruled and led by some discretion that discerns your state better than you yourself. Therefore, I pray you that to our sister you do make return. Say you have wronged her, sir.
Ask her forgiveness? Never, Regan. All the stored vengeances of heaven fall on her ungrateful top. Infect her beauty, you fen-sucked fogs, to fall and blast her pride.
Oh, blessed gods, so will you wish on me when the rash mood is on.
Oh, Regan, thou shalt never have my curse. 'Tis not in thee to grudge my pleasures, to bandy hasty words. Thou better knowest the bonds of childhood, the dues of gratitude. Thy half of the kingdom hast thou not forgot, wherein I thee endowed. Art thou not ashamed to look upon this beard? Oh, Regan, wilt thou take her by the hand?
Why not by the hand, sir? How have I offended? All's not offense that indiscretion finds in dotage terms so.
How came my man in the stocks?
I set him there, sir, but his own disorders deserved much less advancement.
You! Did you?
I pray you, father, being weak, seem so. If till the expiration of your month you will return and sojourn with my sister, dismissing half your train, come then to me.
Return to her and 50 men dismissed? No! Rather I abjure all roofs and choose to wage against the enmity of the air to be a comrade with the wolf and owl.
At your choice, sir.
I prithee, daughter, do not make me mad. I will not trouble thee, my child. Farewell. We'll no more speak, no more see one another. But yet thou art my flesh, my blood, my daughter. Mend when thou canst, be better at thy leisure. I can be patient. I can stay with Regan, I and my 100 knights.
Not altogether so. I am not provided yet, nor am... I looked not for yet, nor am provided for your fit welcome. Give ear, sir, to my sister. She knows what she does.
Is this well spoken?
I dare avouch it, sir. What, 50 followers? Is it not well? What should you need of more? Yea, or so many sit that both charge and danger speak at so great a number. How should many people under two commands hold amity? 'Tis hard. Almost impossible.
Why might not you? My lord, receive attendance from those that she calls servants or from mine.
Why not, my lord? If then they chance to slack you, we could control them. If you will come with me, I entreat you to bring but 25. To no more will I give place or notice.
I gave you all!
And in good time you gave it!
I'll go with thee. Thy 50 yet doth double 25, and thou art twice her love.
Hear me, my lord. What need you 25, 10, or 5 to double in a house where twice so many have a command to tend you?
What need one?
Oh, reason not the need! Allow not nature more than nature needs? Man's life's as cheap as beasts, but for true need. Oh, you heavens! Give me that patience, patience I need. No, you unnatural hags. I will have such revenges on you both that all the world shall. I will do such things. What they are yet I know not, but they shall be the terrors of the earth. You think I'll weep? No, I'll not weep. I have full cause of weeping, but this heart shall break into 100,000 flaws, or ere I'll weep! Oh, fool, I shall go mad!
Let's withdraw, 'twill be a storm.
This house is little. The old man and his people cannot be well bestowed.
His own blame hath put himself from rest and must needs taste his folly.
Alack, the night comes on, the bleak winds do sorely ruffle. For many miles about, there's scarcely a bush.
Oh, sir, to willful men the injuries that they themselves procure must be their schoolmasters. Shut up your doors, he is attended with a desperate train. And what they may incense him to, being apt to have his ear abused, wisdom bids fever.
Shut up your doors, my lord. 'Tis a wild night. My Regan counsels well. Come out unsworn.
Who's there, besides foul weather?
One-minded like the weather, most unquietly.
I know you. Where's the king?
Contending with the fretful element, bids the winds blow the earth into the sea, or swell the curled water above the main, that things might change or cease. Tears his white hair, which the impetuous blasts with eyeless rage, catch in their fury, and make nothing of strives in this little world of man outscored. The to and fro conflicting wind and rain, unbonneted, he runs and bids what will take all.
Sir, I do dare recommend a dear thing to you. There is division. although as yet the face of it be covered with mutual cunning, twixt Albany and Cornwall. From France and Cordelia, there comes a power into the scattered kingdom.
I will talk further with you.
No, do not. If you shall see Cordelia, show her this ring, and she will tell you who your fellow is that yet you do not know. Fie on this storm. I will go seek the king.
Blow winds and crack your cheeks! Rage! Blow!
Oh, nuncle, good nuncle, in and ask thy daughter's blessing. Here's a knight pities neither wise man nor fool.
Rumble thy belly full. Spit fire, spout rain. Your rain, wind, thunder, fire are my daughters. I tax not you, you elements, with unkindness. I never gave you kingdom, called you children. You owe me no subscription, then let fall your horrible pleasure. Here I stand, your slave, a poor, infirm, weak, and despised old man.
Alas, sir, are you here? Things that love night love not such knights as these. Alack, bareheaded. Gracious my lord, hard by here is a hovel. Some friendship will it lend you against the tempest. Repose you there.
My wits begin to turn. Oh, come on, my boy. How dost, my boy? Art cold? I am cold myself. Where is this straw, my fellow? The art of our necessities is strange. I can make vile things precious. Come, your hovel.
He that has and a little tiny wit, with hey, ho, the wind and the rain, must make content with his fortune's fit, for the rain it raineth every day.
True, my good boy. Come, bring us to this hovel.
Here is the place, my lord. Good my lord, enter.
Let me alone.
Good my lord, enter here.
Wilt break my heart?
I had rather break mine own. Good my lord, enter.
In such a night to shut me out. Pour on, I will endure.
Away! The foul fiend follows me.
Hast thou given all to thy two daughters, and art thou come to this?
Who gives anything to poor Tom? Bless thy five wits! Tom's a cold. Oh, do-de-do-de-do. Bless thee from whirlwinds, star-blasting and taking!
What have his daughters brought him to this pass? Couldst thou save nothing, didst thou give them all?
He hath no daughters, sir.
The death, traitor! Nothing could have subdued nature to such a lowness but his unkind daughters.
Pillicock sat on Pillicock Hill. Hello, hello, loo, loo.
This cold night will turn us all to fools and madmen.
Is man no more than this? The lendings?
For thee, nuncle, be contented. 'Tis a naughty night to swim in. Look, here comes a walking fire.
Arise thee, witch! Arise thee!
Who's there? What dost you seek?
Lend with me. My duty cannot suffer to obey all your daughter's hard commands. Though their injunction may be to bar my doors and let this tyrannous knight take hold of you, yet I adventure to come seek you out and bring you both fire and food is ready.
First let me talk with this philosopher. What is the cause of thunder?
Importune him once more to go, my lord. His wits begin to unsettle.
Canst thou blame him? His daughter seek his death. What a night's this! I do beseech your grace.
Oh, cry your mercy, sir. Noble philosopher, your company.
Arms are cold.
In, fellow, there, into the hovel, keep thee warm. No words, no words, hush.
All the power of his wits have given way. The gods reward your kindness.
When we our betters see bearing our woes, we scarcely think our miseries our foes. Who alone suffers, suffers most in the mind, leaving free things and happy shows behind. But then, the mind much sufferance doth o'er skip when grief hath mates and bearing fellowship. How light and portable my pain seems now, when that which makes me bend makes the king bow, he childed as I fathered. What will hap more tonight? Safe scape the king.
Seek out the villain Gloucester.
Instantly.
Pluck out his eyes.
Ingrateful fox, tis he.
And fasten his croaky arms.
What mean your graces? Good my friends, consider you are guests in my home. Do me no foul play, friends.
Oh, filthy traitor!
I'm none! I'm your host, what will you do?
Where hast thou sent the king?
To Dover.
Wherefore to Dover? Wast thou not charged at peril to—
Wherefore to Dover? Let him first—
Wherefore to Dover, sir?
Because I would not see thy cruel nails pluck out his poor old eyes, nor thy sister in his anointed flesh stick boorish fangs. I shall see the winged vengeance overtake such children.
See it thou shalt never. Upon these eyes of thine I set my foot. Out vile jelly. Where is thy luster now?
Dark and comfortless. Where's my son, Edmund? Edmund!
Artless villain, thou callest on him that hates thee. It was he that made the overture of thy treasons to us, who is too good to pity thee.
My follies. Edgar was abused. Kind gods, forgive me!
No. Let himself is sent to Dover.
Have no way, and therefore want no eyes. Oh, dear son Edgar, might I but live to see thee in my touch, I'll say I had eyes again.
Oh, who is't can say I am at the worst? I am worse than e'er I was.
Sirrah, naked fellow.
I cannot.
Come hither, fellow.
And yet I must. Bless thy sweet eyes. They bleed.
Knowest thou the way to Dover?
Aye, master.
There's a cliff whose high and bending head looks fearfully in the confined deep. Bring me but to the very brim of it. I shall repay the misery thou dost bear with something rich about me. From that place I shall no leading need.
Give me thy arm. Poor Tom shall lead thee.
Welcome, my lord. Go, Edmund, to my brother. Hasten his musters and conduct his powers. Wear this. Spare speech. This kiss, if it durst speak, should stretch thy spirits up into the air. Fare you well.
Yours in the ranks of death.
My most dear Gloucester. Oh, the difference, man and man.
Oh, Goneril, you're not worth the dust with the rude wind blows in your face.
No more, the text is foolish.
What have you done? A father and a gracious aged man. Have you matted?
Milk-livered man, where's thy drum? France spreads his banners in your noiseless land, whilst thou, a moral fool, sit'st still and criest, alack, why does he so?
Tee thyself, devil.
O vain fool.
What news?
Oh, my good lord, the Duke of Cornwall is dead, slain by his servant going to put out the other eye of Gloucester.
Or poor Gloucester, I live to thank thee for the love thou showest the king, and to revenge thine eyes.
When shall we come to the top of that same hill?
You do climb up it now. Look how we labor.
Methinks the ground is even.
Horrible steep. Hark! Do you hear the sea?
No, truly.
Why then? Your other senses grow imperfect by your eyes' anguish.
So it may be indeed. Methinks thy voice is altered.
You're much deceived. In nothing am I changed but in my garments.
Methinks you are better spoken.
Come on, sir. Here's the place. Stand still. How fearful and dizzy 'tis to cast one's eyes so low. I'll look no more, lest my brain turn and I topple down headlong.
Set me where you stand.
You are now within a foot of the extreme verge.
Let go my hand and go thou farther off. Bid me farewell and let me hear thee going.
Now fare you well, good sir.
With all my heart. Oh, you mighty gods! In your sights, I do patiently shake my great affliction off. If Edgar live, oh, bless him.
Alive or dead? Ho you, sir, friend? Hear you, sir, speak? What are you, sir?
Away and let me die.
Hadst thou been aught but gossamer, feathers, air, so many fathom down precipitating. Thou'st shivered like an egg, but thou dost breathe, hast heavy substance, bleeds not, speak'st art sound. 10 masts that each make not the altitude which thou hast perpendicularly fell. Thy life's a miracle. Speak yet again.
But have I fallen or no?
From the dread summit, do but look up.
Alack, I have no eyes. Is wretchedness deprived that benefit to end itself by death?
Give me your arm. Up, so, how is't? Feel ye your legs? You stand.
Too well, too well.
The gods have preserved thee.
Henceforth, I'll bear affliction till it do cry out itself, enough, enough, and die.
But who comes here?
No, they cannot touch me. I am the king himself.
Oh, thou side-piercing sight.
Peace, peace. This piece of toasted cheese will do it.
I know that voice.
Ha! With rain kept to wet me once, and the wind to make me chatter, when the thunder would not peace at my bidding, there I found him, there I smelt him out. Go to, they are not men of their words. They told me I was everything. 'Tis a lie.
Is it not the king?
Aye, every inch a king. When I do stare, see how the subject quakes.
Oh, ruined piece of nature, dost thou know me?
Let me wipe it first. It smells of mortality.
Dost thou know me?
I remember thine eyes well enough. If thou'lt weep my fortunes, take my eyes. I know thee well enough. Thy name is Gloucester. When we are born, we cry that we are come to this great stage of fools. I'll put it in proof. And when I have stolen upon these sons-in-laws, then kill, 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 kill.
There you are. Lay a hand upon him, sir, your most dear daughter.
No rescue? What, a prisoner? Come, come, I am a king.
You are a royal one, and we obey you.
There's life in it. Nay, if you get it, you shall get it with running! Sa, 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 sa!
News, madam. The British powers are marching hitherward.
'Tis known before. Our troops stand in expectation of them. Oh, dear father, it is thy business that I go about. No blown ambition doth our arms incite, but love. Dear love, and our aged father's right. Soon may I hear and see him.
To both these sisters have I sworn my love. Each, jealous of the other, as the stung are of the adder. Which of them shall I take? Both? One? Or neither? Neither can be enjoyed if both remain alive.
Now, sweet lord, you know the goodness I intend upon you. Tell me, but truly, but then speak the truth. Do you not love my sister?
An honored love.
I never shall endure her. Dear my lord, be not familiar with her.
Fear me not.
I had rather lose the battle than that sister should loosen him and me.
Thou good Kent, how shall I live and work to match thy goodness?
To be acknowledged, madam, is o'erpaid.
How does the king?
Madam, sleeps still.
Oh, dear father, restoration hang medicine on my lips, and let this kiss repair. He wakes, speak to him.
Madam, do you, 'tis fittest.
How does my royal lord? How fares your majesty?
You do me wrong to take me out of the grave.
Sir, do you know me?
You are a spirit, I know. When did you die?
Oh, look upon me, sir. No. Sir, you must not kneel.
Pray, do not mock me. I'm a very foolish and fond old man. And to deal plainly, I fear I am not in my perfect mind. Methinks I should know you and know this man. Yet I am doubtful, for I am mainly ignorant. What place this is, do not laugh at me, for as I am a man, I think this lady to be my child Cordelia.
And so I am.
Do not abuse me.
Will please your highness walk?
You must bear with me. Pray you now, forget and forget, for I am old and foolish.
Is it true, sir, that the Duke of Cornwall was so slain?
Most certain, sir.
Who is the conductor of his people?
'Tis said Edmund, bastard son of Gloucester.
They say Edgar, his banished son, is with the Earl of Kent.
Report is changeable. 'Tis time to look about. The powers of the kingdom approach apace.
The adventurement is likely to be bloody. Fare you well, sir.
My point and period will be thoroughly wrought. Or well or ill, is this day's battle fought.
Away, old man, give me thy hand, away! King Lear hath lost, he and his daughter ta'en. Give me thy hand, come on!
No farther, sir, man may rot even here.
What, in ill thoughts again? Men must endure. Come on.
Shall we not see these daughters and these sisters?
No, 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 no. Come, let's away to prison. We two alone will sing like birds in the cage. And when thou dost ask me blessing, I kneel down and ask of thee forgiveness, so we'll live and pray and sing and tell old tales and laugh at gilded butterflies and hear poor rogues talk of poor news. We'll talk of them too. Who loses and who wins? Who's in, who's out, and take upon the mystery of things as if we were gods, spies, and we'll wear out a walled prison and packs and sects of great ones that ebb and flow by the moon. Upon such sacrifices, my Cordelia, the gods themselves throw incense. Have I caught thee? He that parts us shall bring a brand from heaven and fire us hence like foxes. Wipe thine eyes, the good year shall devour them, flesh and fell, ere they shall make us weep. We'll see him starve first, come.
Sir, you've shown today your valiant strain, but sir, by your patience, I hold you but a subject of this war, not as a brother.
That's as we list to grace him. He led our powers, bore the commission of my place and person, the which immediacy may call itself your brother.
Not so hot. In his own grace he doth exalt himself more than in your addition.
In my rights, by me invested, he compares the best.
That were the most if he should husband you.
Jesters too oft prove prophets.
Holla, holla, that eye that told you so looked but a squint.
Lady, I am not well, else I should answer you from a full-flowing stomach. General, take thou my soldiers, prisoners, patrimony, dispose of them, of me. The walls are thine, witness the world that I create thee here, my lord and master.
Mean you to enjoy him?
Edmund, let the drum strike and prove my title thine.
Say yet, hear reason. Edmund, I arrest thee on capital treason. For your claim, fair sister, I bar in the interest of my wife, till she's subcontracted to this lord, and I, her husband, contradict your bans. And if you will marry her, make your loves to me. My lady is best spoke, with a trumpet sound, and if none appear to prove upon thy head thy heinous manifest and many treasons, there is my pledge. I prove it on thy heart.
Sick. Oh, sick!
Not, I'll ne'er trust medicine.
There's my exchange. He that names me traitor, villain-like he lies. I will maintain my truth and honor firmly.
Sick press upon me!
Who is he that speaks for Edmund, Earl of Gloucester?
Himself. What sayest thou to him?
Thou art a traitor, false to thy gods, thy brother, and thy father, and from thy head to thy foot, a most toad-spotted traitor. Sayst thou no? This arm and my best spirits are bent to prove upon thy heart whereto I speak, thou liest.
In wisdom, I should ask thy name, but, rule of knighthood, I disdain and spurn. Back do I toss these treasons to your head. With the hell-hated lie o'erwhelm thy heart, this arm of mine shall give rest forever.
Hold, sir. Thou worse than any name. Read thine own evil. No tailing, lady. I perceive you know it.
Say, if I do, the laws are mine, not thine. Who can arraign me for it?
Oh, monstrous, knowest this paper?
Ask me not what I know.
What you have charged me with, that have I done. And more, much more. The time will bring it out. Tis past, and so am I. But what art thou that hast this fortune on me?
My name is Edgar, and thy father's son.
The wheel has come full circle. I am here.
That sorrow split my heart. If I ever did hate thee or thy father, how have you hid yourself? How have you known the miseries of your father?
By nursing them, my lord. Oh, that my heart would burst. Never, oh, fault revealed myself unto him until some half hour passed, when I was sure of this good success. But his heart, alack, too weak the conflict to support, twixt two extremes of passion, joy and grief, burst smilingly. What means that bloody knife?
'Tis hot. It smokes. It came from the heart of... Oh, she's dead.
Who dead? Speak, man.
Your lady, sir. Your lady and her sister. By her is poison. She hath confessed it.
Yet Edmund was beloved. The one the other poisoned for my sake. And after slew herself. I pant for life. Some good I mean to do. Quickly, send to the castle. For my writ is on the life of Lear and on Cordelia. Nay, send in time.
Run, run, or run!
Ha-ho! Ha-ho! How, how, how she's gone forever. A plague upon you murders, traitors all. I might have saved her. Now she's gone forever. Cordelia, Cordelia, stay a little. What if thou sayest? Her voice was ever soft. No, 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 life, my poor fool is hanged. Why should a dog, a horse, a rat have life? Thou no breath at all. Thou'lt come no more. Never, 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 never. Look on her. Look. Look there. Look there.
He faints. My lord. Look up, my lord.
Vex not his ghost. Oh, let him pass.
He is gone indeed.
It is a wonder he endured so long. He but usurped his life.
Friends of my soul, you twain rule this realm, and the gored state sustain. The way of this sad time, you must obey. Speak what we feel, not what we ought to say. The old hath borne most, we that are young. Shall never see so much, nor live so long.
Speak.
Nothing, my lord.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Nothing.
We'll come of nothing.
Speak again.
Thank you.